Welcome to Insight, today produced in partnership with KCOS 13 El Paso Public Television. Today we are chatting with Diane Flanagan, Chief Executive Officer of Girl Scouts of the Desert Southwest. Diane has generously agreed to share some of her experience with us. I'd like to thank you, Diane, for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me here.
So Girl Scouts?
Yeah.
Cookies, right?
Everybody knows those for cookies.
Everybody knows, mm-hmm. But Girl Scouts are not just about cookies.
Yes.
Talk about the non-cookie aspect of Girl Scouts.
Okay, but I also have to talk about the cookie aspect of cookies. Basically, Girl Scouts, we've been around for 105 years. So everyone knows this. It's a great brand awareness, and everybody has good feelings about Girl Scouts. And the reason for that is because we're a leadership development program at our core. We take girls and really allow them the opportunities to learn and lead for themselves and learn those skills to advance whatever it is they're doing in their life, whether it's to run their family or run a business or whatever they choose to do. So at its core, this is a program that really teaches girls how to be leaders in their own lives for their futures.
So talk about the kind of programs and the type of leadership that girls get to express.
We do pretty much anything. Today, we're really focused on four main things. Of course, STEM. I am an engineer, so that's near and dear to my heart.
Science, technology, engineering, math.
Yes.
And girls are great scientists. Girls make great technologists, great engineers, great mathematicians.
But we're very underrepresented in STEM fields in this country. So, and girls love it. And if you look at the statistics, we have a Girl Scout Research Institute. And if you look at the statistics, Girl Scouts are so much more interested in STEM because they're exposed to it. And they do it in a fun way, too. So it's really important that we have a STEM focus because we're creating the workforce of the future. The girls are terribly underrepresented, especially in things like computer science. And we're developing that pipeline for the future.
Plus, one of the things that has been established is that girls address problems in a fundamentally different way than boys. And so by taking that energy and freeing that energy, all of a sudden you're freeing the creative and productive force for the American and world economy.
Absolutely. And the other thing is that research shows that when you have a gender-balanced organization and a gender-balanced board, mm-hmm. so in other words, it's not all white male or it's not all female, that they outperform boards that are not gender-balanced. So in corporations today, you need both voices at the table. It makes you stronger.
So you have your STEM program.
Yes.
What other programs?
We also work and focus on life skills. So there's a lot of kids today that aren't learning some basic skills, how to change a tire, how to do just basic life skill things. And we're teaching that to our girls as well. We have lots of programs on that.
So when my mom was a little girl, it was how to be a lady and how to cook cupcakes.
Right.
But now we're talking about how to change tires.
Oh, absolutely. Now, we still do baking and we still do great things like that, too. But we also add to that. We have a car care program that we do here every year that's just wonderful. It's how to change your oil, how to change your tire, how to maintain your car. Girls aren't learning that today unless they have, you know, a little bit more progressive parents who are teaching that. And Girl Scouts learn life skills.
And it's part of the empowering.
Absolutely.
And you have two other programs?
Well, we also focus on the outdoors. We've always been about being outdoors and camping, and we have great resources for getting outdoors. And we know, again, through research, that girls that do get outdoors, they're more challenge-seeking, they're more environmentally conscious, so they're more likely to do things to save our environment. And they learn problem-solving skills that you were talking about earlier in a way that you don't learn if you're not outdoors. And of course, the confidence with being outside and rappelling off a cliff is you can't put a value on that. So outdoors is the other piece of what we do. It's a real big piece of what we do. And the fourth is entrepreneurship, and that brings us back to the cookie program. Because, you know, people know us for selling cookies because we're out there everywhere. It's an $850 million business across this country. But when girls sell cookies, they're learning how to run a business. They're learning how to set their goals. They're learning how to meet with customers, how to upsell in some cases, how to close a business deal, how to account for all of their inventory. And they're learning to run a business for the first time in their lives. And if you talk to professional, successful women, you'll often find that they relate their cookie sale experience as their first business experience.
So talk about the architecture of your staff, your volunteers, mm-hmm. and how that day unfolds.
Well, in Girl Scouts of the Desert Southwest, we serve over 11,000 girls. We have about 2,300 committed volunteers that help lead those girls.
So 2,300 committed volunteers.
Yes.
What does committed mean?
That means that they are actively involved in running a troop or supporting a troop or helping us support programs when we go into schools, just a whole variety of things.
And it's a considerable time commitment.
Yes, yes. The Girl Scout volunteer, it is a larger time commitment than pretty much most volunteer opportunities today, which is a difficulty for our organization because as you've got younger volunteers and millennials, they're not used to putting in the kind of time that our volunteers traditionally have to put in Girl Scouts.
Right.
We're doing a lot of things to address that, but that's continuing to be a problem. As our society changes, there's less available time for people to volunteer.
Well, let's not put too fine a point on it.
Yeah.
The Girl Scouts have grown up during eras where the expectation was that women were not going to be professionally employed
right.
and had more disposable time
right.
to invest in these types of activities. That's
right.
no longer the case.
That's very true. So what we've done is a lot of research on how to appeal to the volunteer to express exactly what the girl is getting out of this organization, to express what the volunteer is getting out of this organization. And at the same time, we're trying to make it a simpler process. We, in our council here last June, we just developed and implemented a whole IT program where volunteers now can run a troop meeting with their phone, their smartphone, and it will break down everything that they need to run a troop meeting, and it includes communication tools back to the parent saying, this is what your daughter did today. So we're trying to become more into the 21st century with our technology because we know that our volunteers are going to need that.
Well, that's so interesting because with this change in society, you need to create responses, and one of your responses that you're highlighting is a technological response
right.
that
right.
takes into account the fact that we all lead mobile-centric lives.
Yes.
And so creating an app that allows people to communicate, that mm-hmm. allows people to create community, you're basically taking lessons from the new economy, from
yes.
the social media connection that we all feel today.
Yes. We have to do that. We have to. We often talk about moving at the speed of girl. And you know, our younger children, they move fast.
Yes.
And an organization that's 105 years old, it's not so good at moving very fast. So this is something that we're working on to try to speed up with the new volunteer. At the same time, we've done a lot of research on what is it that a parent wants for their child. And we talked about this earlier. The number one thing that a parent wants for their daughter is a place for them to take risks. And we definitely do that. They want for their child a place where they can try new things in that safe environment because they know that that's going to reap rewards for their child forever. That, you know, it comes over fear of trying new things. It allows them to just succeed in almost anything they do. So that's the number one thing that a parent wants for their child. And we provide that. So it's a matter of getting that message out there to say, we know what you want, and this is the organization that provides that.
One of the issues has been with many of these traditional organizations mm-hmm. is that the organization's membership has been split along socioeconomic lines, racial, ethnic lines,
right.
linguistic lines.
Right.
How do you deal with that in a border town of El Paso?
Well, it's a bit of a challenge because we are very heavily Hispanic here, and the Hispanic families don't have the long tradition of knowing Girl Scouts, so they're not as familiar with Girl Scouts. Also, when you talk in a Hispanic family, especially a first generation, and you talk to the father in the family about leadership and use the word leader, that doesn't really translate so well. And they're thinking, you know, I'm not sure I want my daughter to be, you know, a leader. I want her to be a great mom and run a great family, and that is being a leader. So we have to make sure we're communicating properly. So I have a staff that is with at parity with our demographics, and that allows them access. You have to mirror your community to have access in your community.
And that creates a change of the organization itself.
Right.
The organization exposes itself to the different sensibilities that are reflective of a particular community, and then transforms. And maybe that dialogue that you facilitate through electronic means, that you facilitate through linguistic capabilities, that your staff reflects the community, maybe that's all part of that secret sauce that is allowing you to expand your membership.
We still have great opportunity here. We still only serve about 5% of the eligible girls. And nationally, that number is closer to 7%. So we still have that opportunity. We still are underserved in some of our communities, and we have opportunity because of that.
What's next?
So we went to some funders, and we have funding to fund staff members to go into the communities and start leading troops, actually running the troop. This is very different from a traditional thing. What we traditionally do is go out and recruit volunteers, train the volunteers, they run the troops. This is a little bit different because we know that the volunteers don't feel like they have the skills to lead a troop yet. So we have funded staff members that go in. It's easy to find the girls. So they start the troop, they engage some parents, and they bring them all along together for a period of 1 to 2 months. And they run the troop meetings with the parents and kind of are training the parents to be leaders in the troop setting at the same time.
So this is
very successful.
This is pump priming. I mean, basically, you're coming in. Are you embraced by the parents in those communities? Because it is sometimes sensitive
sometimes
to come in from
different.
Outside.
The biggest thing is that the parents are somewhat disconnected too, and they don't feel like they have the skills to lead a group of girls.
So they're welcoming.
Exactly. They are. Because they know the benefit for the girl, and they don't feel like they can do it themselves. So we have paid staff members that are donor funded that work with the girls and the parents, and are basically training the parents and giving them the confidence in being able to run a troop. And they stay with them for a month to 2 months, sometimes longer, whatever they need. And once that troop is fully formed, then they have time to start another one. It's been very successful for us.
That's phenomenal. So so people are coming in, they're transferring knowledge, they're working themselves out of a job in that community and then starting up a next troop.
Exactly.
So you're actually seeding, this is a marketing and an evangelizing function.
And then think about this, once that troop is fully formed, then they start the product sales program, they start selling cookies, now they're
self-sufficient.
They're self-sufficient, exactly.
Diane Flanagan, thank you so much for sharing the work of the Girl Scouts of the Desert Southwest.
I love what I do.
And thank you so much
Thank you
insights.
So much. I appreciate it.